the pod bay doors, please, Hal.
I need your deck. This is a bad one. The worst yet.
There was an escape from the off-world colonies 2 weeks ago. 6 replicants. 3 male, 3 female. They slaughtered 20...
A Blade Runner's job is to hunt down replicants. Manufactured humans you can't tell from the real thing.
What's this?
Roy Batty. Probably the leader.
There was just one outfit making replicants that superhuman. The Terrell Corporation.
Mr. Deckard, Dr. Eldon Tyrell.
I don't get it, Tyrell.
Commerce is our goal here at Tyrell. More human than human is our motto.
I was looking for 6 replicants in a city of 106 million people.
You ever see this girl, huh?
Never seen her. Buzz love.
What I didn't know was they were looking for me.
Questions.
I just do eyes. Just genetic design. Just eyes.
Hello?
I'm in a bar here now, down in the 4th sector. Why don't you come on down here and have a drink?
That's not my kind of place.
Time to die.
If I didn't care, more than words can say. If I didn't care, would I feel this way? If this isn't love, then why?
Excuse me, Miss Salome, can I talk to you for a minute?
Are you for real?
He's a damn one-man slaughterhouse.
I'm going home.
Pod bay doors are open. Welcome once again. I'm your host, Jerry Dean Roberts of ArmchairCinema.com and also ArmchairOscars.com. And seated across the country from me is a man that I'm fairly sure is real and not a replicant, the critic and, dare I say, legend from TalkMovieToMe.com, the one and only, you know him, you love him, Mr. Doug Keller. How the heck are you today, sir?
I was quit when I came in here, Bryant. I'm twice as quit now.
You'll never quit this show.
This show is like
the mafia.
No choice, huh?
This show is like the mafia. We tell you when you can leave.
Okay. Once I thought I was out, they pull me back in.
Oh, wait, there is no mafia. Uh-huh. Yeah, that's it.
There's not much of one anymore, but...
No. But today we're traveling, I guess, into the future...
Into the future, past, pluperfect...
Present.
Yes.
We're talking about Blade Runner. And later on, we're going to talk about its follow-up, Blade Runner 2049. Which, one film I like, the other one, eh.
I have a weird relationship with Blade Runner.
As do I. So let's get into it.
I saw Blade Runner for the first time, I think I was a sophomore in college. That was before the final cut, so that was the 92 director's cut. Was the best
98 was the final cut, right?
2006, I think, was the final cut.
Okay.
The director's cut was in 92, and I...
Which is the one that ends with the suggestion that Edward James Olmos is a replicant?
None.
I think that was the director's cut.
Well, the director's cut and the final cut have the unicorn daydream in them, but that's Deckard, not...
Okay.
But the unicorn at the end is meant to symbolize that Gaff knows that Deckard has had that dream. That's where the implication of the replicant comes in.
Okay.
That if he is aware of an implanted image, there might be an implanted image in there, and he might not be real.
Okay.
And you never really find out. Harrison Ford maintains that he was a man, that he was real, and Ridley Scott has liked to say that he believes that he's a replicant. So and
even
they,
the sequel never really tells you.
No, no. And I guess Ford and Scott to this day have loud arguments about whether Deckard is a replicant or not. Because Ford didn't want that. But so I saw this and I didn't like it, but I was captivated by it.
Mm-hmm. Like that's the general feeling.
It just wormed its way.
When you're on the fence.
Yeah, and then I had a pop culture class that was doing noir, and my teacher adores Blade Runner.
Yeah.
He was probably about your age, so he grew up, maybe he's a little bit older, so he was a kid when it came out, so he got to see it in the theater, and, you know, or he was in college when it came out, or something like that. So he was just, like, right in the right place at the right time, and he saw the theatrical cut, which has Deckard's narration, making it more noir-y. So then every paper I wrote was about Blade Runner because I couldn't get it out of my head.
Right.
So like 3, 4, 5 papers, and I keep rewatching and rewatching and rewatching, but I still don't quite get over the hump.
You're sitting there and you're watching it and you're going, this is a visionary masterpiece.
Mm-hmm.
It's a story well told, but there is a piece that is missing. It's like there's an element to it that I was the same way. It's just like there's an element to this that is just not hooking up with me.
Well, there's no emotional connection.
It's not an emotional experience.
There's no emotional connection to any of this. The entire film is very cold. For me, I think that's why it works as like an ultra neo-noir.
Yeah.
Because in the best noir films noir, you don't really care or like the protagonist, but you're still kind of on their side. I'm thinking like Robert Mitchum in
Out of the Past,
or you know, you don't have much of a sympathy for them.
Or the movies we've talked about. We talked about The Maltese Falcon. Mm-hmm. We talked about Scarlet Street. We talked about Lost Weekend.
Yeah.
All of those are that noir feel where you don't love the character.
Right. Well, I'll tell you my preparation for this, and it was a little extreme.
Let me put it this way. Let me preface this by saying you had far more devotion to this movie than I did. I saw the final cut.
This was not...
And you saw...
All 5 cuts.
There are actually 7 of them, but...
In 3 days... Well, all 5 in the big final cut Blu-ray box set.
The briefcase? Is that the briefcase?
No, it's just a regular case. It's, like, super thick, but... Mm. and I watched them in chronological order. I went from work print to 82 U.S. theatrical, 82 international theatrical, 92 director's cut, and then the final cut.
Okay, so tell me sort of a sentence for each one.
Well, the work print is 7 minutes shorter than the other four cuts, and is the slowest, most annoying, most boring version of all of them. Mm. So I can understand when Warner Brothers saw that, why they freaked out and recut it. The 82 US version and the international version are fairly similar.
Yeah, they're almost similar. There's like 3 minutes difference between
difference,
them.
But they're both the same running time. So it's all in the editing. So you have to know this movie to know where the cuts, where the differences are. I only
if this
noticed,
was Star Wars, I could spot it.
Oh, absolutely. I could still spot all of them in Star Wars. This one, I only started to notice some differences while I was watching all the cuts together. And I'd seen, I think, the work print. I'd seen the 92 cut, the final cut, and I think I'd seen the beginning of the U.S. theatrical. But that was it, but never in as condensed a period of time as I did it with these, which was, I did all five in 3 days.
Bless your heart.
And then I watched 2049.
Yeah.
It was a week, once I got through Blade Runner 2049, I started something else and was just like elated that it didn't have anything to do with Blade Runner.
If you want to watch 2049... don't make any other plans for the rest of the evening.
Yeah.
Because that's going to be your evening.
Yeah, it's... it's not a short film.
It's a long movie. It's 2 hours and 43 minutes long.
Right. And... which is... about 46 minutes longer than the first one. So... the work print's 110 minutes, and all four other versions are 117 minutes. So he did not just stick in an extra few minutes just to make it a director's cut and a final cut. He recut the whole damn thing.
Okay, now I've seen three of these.
Uh-huh.
I saw the final cut for this.
Uh-huh. Oh, this was the first time you'd seen the final cut.
It's been a while. Because I don't come back to this movie very often. I've seen the director's cut, which to me is the best. And I saw, and I don't know which one it is. It's the one they stick on Sci-Fi, on the Sci-Fi channel. The one with that damn narration.
Well, then that's probably either the U.S. or the international theatrical cut.
I think that's the U.S. international. That's the first one I saw.
Both of them have that needlessly expository voiceover.
You mean the version that treats you like a child?
Yes.
Like you don't, you're not going to understand anything if I don't tell you everything that's happening?
Yes. It takes a lot of the intelligence out of it. Because this is...
it takes a lot of mystique out of it.
Oh, yeah, the mystique, the intelligence. This is a very smart movie.
Well, and Harrison Ford is not a master of dialogue.
No.
He's not a master of long passages of dialogue.
He's best when he's getting
hit. He's a better actor than he's given credit for. But
oh, absolutely. He knows how to take a punch, man.
Yeah, he does. Yes. It's that vulnerability, I think, that people love. He had it in Star Wars. He had it in Blade Runner. He had it in Indiana Jones. Absolutely, but he's not an emotive actor when it comes to long stretches of dialogue like that.
Not really. No.
But Blade Runner, I'm going to tell you, and I have only come back to this occasionally, but the first time I saw it was on television, and that was the one with the narration. Mm-hmm. And that was when I was a kid. Mm-hmm. I came back to it for the director's cut in 1998.
Okay.
And I saw it in a theater. Hmm. I saw it at the Alabama Theater in downtown Birmingham, and with a theater full of Blade Runner fans, which that's an experience.
Probably helped.
And then I saw the final cut. Mm-hmm. I won't say that I didn't like the final cut. I do very much. But in all three versions, I have exactly the same problem. My feet are not in this movie. I am ringside. I'm not in the ring. In the best movies, I'm in the ring. In this one, I'm not. I'm outside of the experience. And a lot of it comes from the fact that I don't care about these characters, and particularly the replicants, because what they do is they try to make you feel as if the replicants are victims, and they are, mm-hmm. but they create them as stone-cold killers.
Right. You can feel a modicum of sympathy for them because they are self-aware, they know they're going to die at four, they know how old they are, they know when they're going to die, and they are basically just used as tools. They are
slave labor.
Well, yeah, they are what slavery always was. They're not considered human. They're skin jobs and all this
disposable kind
of stuff. Like, yeah, they're not treated as real people, but they are sentient beings. So they are victimized.
But the character of Roy Batty is created as this steely-eyed, stone-cold killer.
Well, yeah, because he's a military unit. So,
and then the movie tries, in the last 3 minutes of the movie, to give him a little bit of humanity that it has avoided for the rest of the movie.
True.
And that's the problem I had when I was watching it the other night. I'm thinking, and I was talking about the piece that I felt was missing. And when I was watching it, I thought, that's the piece that's missing. I don't feel a questions of humanity here.
See, for me, I put the replicant's plight more universally. Mm. I don't feel sympathy for these replicants, because by the time they got to Earth, they'd already killed 23 people.
Right.
But in general, I understand where they're coming from, why they're doing it, and it's really not much different than the beginnings of other revolutions.
Yeah.
The only thing is, this revolution couldn't last long. Mm-hmm. Because they got
they
4 years. Whatever the last incept date, just stop making them, and then upgrade them like they do in 2049, and then your problem's over. Like, you can just kind of wait out a war with replicants.
But now I want to talk about the thing that I do love about this movie, and that is the world it creates.
Mm-hmm.
Because I complained about it pretty much in our last two shows, but watching it again, I realize this is not, for me, film noir. This does not remind me of film noir. This reminds me of anime.
Mm-hmm.
This reminds me of, and almost story-wise and visually, reminds me of both what I loved and what I didn't love about Ghost in the Shell, which is the story is thin, the characters are very thin, I'm not invested in what's going on with them, but I am fascinated by the visual look,
mm-hmm.
by what is going on. What's interesting is I don't really consider this to be our future. I consider this to be an anime-style future.
An anime-style future that could have only been envisioned in 1982.
Right. Because if you think about it, it's envisioning the future of that 1982,
mm-hmm.
and what's going to be around.
And in that 1982, I think it's spot on. I mean, we're pretty much there without all of the wondrous scientific advancements.
Well,
like, that's our society, just we don't have flying cars and replicants, and we're not off-world.
One thing that I think is important to note is, in 1982, the America was being, I won't say taken over, but was very much under the influence of Japanese marketing. Mm-hmm. We're taking a lot of Japanese products. We're buying smaller cars from Japan.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that was the 80s were like the advent of Japan's economic.
Right. And imported into that was anime. Mm-hmm. So you would imagine a screenwriter sitting there in 1982 thinking, okay, well, what's going to be the future based on what we're going through now? Well, the future is going to look a little more probably like a future Tokyo. Mm-hmm. It's going to look a little more like, you would imagine, because you look around and what do you see? You see Toshiba. You see all of these different things, TDK and things like that.
And they're speaking mishmashes of different languages.
Dialects, yeah.
There's Chinese, Japanese, German, Dutch, English, all like rolled into this like street slang kind of thing that like Anthony Burgess would probably cried when he heard this because he invented the slang for A Clockwork Orange.
Yeah.
But at least you could figure it out from context.
And it helped, and it helped when Burgess wrote the Clockwork Orange. It had its own glossary.
Yours might have. Mine didn't.
Mine had its own glossary, so you could figure out what the words were.
I wish mine had a glossary.
Excuse me. But the funny thing is, it's like got all of these technological advancements that's just nothing but advertising. Coca, there are two products. There are two major products in this world. Atari and Coca-Cola.
Yeah, the Atari one is the one that how you can tell that this is not...
This is 1982.
Yeah.
Of course, you have all those big signs. The one of the most famous is the geisha woman, the geisha who is eating... I'm guessing she's eating a chocolate or something. I don't know.
I'm not sure. But that's the most indelible image. When you look at it and if you pause it, you can definitely get manga panels.
Yeah. You can animate this.
Comic panels. Mm-hmm. You could put this into a comic book and it would be seamless. What I love about it, I love the world. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And I think don't want to live in it.
I wouldn't want to live in it, but we kind of do. It's very reminiscent of... It's not a huge leap for me to put myself in a future wherein that happens, much like it's not hard for me to envision an alien future. Which apparently, according to Scott, these two films are in the same universe.
Yeah.
So the alien stuff is like 100 years after this, 150 years after this. But I can totally get where, like, the Wayland Corporation would have emerged out of Tyrell and this other one from 2049. Like, there's a clear line.
You could imagine that the Nostromo is just off-world.
Yeah, exactly.
But I want to ask you a question. I thought about this the other night while I was watching it and it made me laugh. Did you get this while you were watching it? Deckard is terrible at his job. He's just not very good at it because when he kills the replicant played by Joanna Cassidy, when he kills her almost by accident because he chases her through a crowd. And he's lucky he didn't kill six more people while shooting into a crowd.
Well, that's...
And he only got saved because how many times in this movie does he basically get his ass handed to him?
Oh, every time he's on screen.
And the only reason he survives a beating by Brian James is because Sean Young killed Brian James.
Well, yes. But...
But he may also be the best at his job at the same time.
Well, he has to be because, see, there's one thing about him that leads me to believe that he is very good at his job. Mm. He's alive.
Yeah.
that kind of job, mm-hmm. if you're not alive, you're not good.
Right, right.
So, I mean, yes, he kills her at a long range. But the fact that he kills them yeah. actually makes him good at his job.
Yeah, that's true.
If he missed and she got away and he hit six onlookers.
He'd be taken, yeah.
Right, then there would
but
be...
But you also have to consider he's running down a street that is crowded with mobs of people. You move forward and you run into a person. You step back and you're going to run over a car, or a car is going to run over you. Mm-hmm. One or the other. You're all packed in.
Mm-hmm. And
there's no place to move.
Weirdly enough, there are a lot of people walking for Los Angeles.
Yeah.
Like a whole lot of people on the ground.
And they're walking. They've got these umbrellas, and the stick part is lit up. Looks like a lightsaber,
mm-hmm.
but it looks like something you would buy at the dollar store for you know. It looks like something you buy at the dollar store.
Mm-hmm.
It looks like something that a prop guy in 1982 would go, "Ooh, this looks futuristic."
Yeah, yeah. See, for me, I realized why this just gets like a worm and just sticks inside my head and makes me want to watch it over and over.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't think I'd be able to make it through all five, and I ended up watching two cuts in the same day at
yeah.
one point. It's because I get where the pace would be a turnoff for people,
mm-hmm.
because the action is only in very short bursts.
And it's mostly at the end.
Right. What I can actually say that I do love about it is that it takes the time and it shows the detective process.
Yeah.
In not a boring way.
Yeah.
It's very few films that mm-hmm. feature a detective actually feature detection.
Yeah. Actually doing the work.
The way that they did Blade Runner is kind of how I want a Batman movie to be.
Mm.
Like him actually like figuring out and working it out instead of just randomly happening on what was going down, you know, or figuring it out at the last second. He's going through the paces. He's looking at the footage. He goes undercover, putting pieces of the puzzle together. Yeah, and he goes undercover to go visit the replicant at the sex parlor.
They did a lot of that in the animated series. They did a little bit of that in Dark Knight, a little mm-hmm. bit.
Yeah.
But yeah, that's the best of Batman.
Yeah. So like, I would love if they actually made a movie about the world's greatest detective that shows him detecting.
Doing his job.
Something. Right. It's
not
like,
just beating up criminals.
Right. It's the early versions of Sherlock Holmes, or the TV show with Benedict Cumberbatch and Martin Freeman, instead mm-hmm. of the Robert Downey Jr. Jude Law ones. That is just
because we Americans are such dim-witted Philistines that we can't watch a man do his job. We have to watch this nonsense action junk.
That was written and directed by an Englishman. So
I know, but it treats us like idiots.
Yes, yes. That's what I think has been holding on to me with this, because I enjoy watching him go through the paces. I enjoy the fact that this is not, they're not all huddled together. There's not, well, they kind of know where they are and they've narrowed it down and now there's a big strike at the end with a whole big police force and all this. It was one guy doing his job.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I admire that about it. And the sequel is the same.
The sequel does it a lot better. And I think it's largely because there's more time to build on it. But when I was watching this the other night, I was fascinated, but at the same time also frustrated. Because...
Yeah, that's Blade Runner.
That's Blade Runner. That's it. I remember as I was growing up, I remember when home video was coming around, and everybody, there was this small cult that kind of, because this movie did not do all that well.
No, it did not.
Neither of them did. This small cult that sort of gathered around Blade Runner. And I tried watching it, and I was trying to grab hold of what it was that everybody was so fascinated by. And it went right by me. Mm-hmm. But I understand and admire their passion. Blade Runner has never been a movie that I've been able to fall in love with. But the problems that I have are generally that it has questions about humanity, but sort of misaligns that humanity in a way that just kind of pulls me out of the movie.
Yeah.
Because it's asking me to care about characters who spend most of the movie doing things that are reprehensible.
Right, and Deckard's no better.
No, no.
Like, he just doesn't want to be doing what he's doing, knows he can't get out of it, so he's just doing it to get out. And yeah. I really enjoy that. It does set up... When I look at it, I agree with you. I don't see noir.
Mm-hmm. I know he was doing Philip Marlowe.
Oh, absolutely. This... When you pay attention to the story and you watch the beats and the writing, it's very noir. It's probably one of the best sci-fi noirs. This and Dark City, which is something that we'll have to talk about.
Dark City is just...
Dark City is brilliant.
Dark City is a brilliant, forgotten, unfairly maligned movie. That I saw in a theater, and I was dazzled by.
I didn't see it in the theater, but I've seen it a couple of times, and I think I bought the director's cut Blu-ray, but I don't think I watched it.
It plays on a lot of the themes that this one's striving for.
Mm-hmm. Well, you can tell that this was very much an influence for that. That Blade Runner was a big influence on...
And it's all influenced by Metropolis.
Mm-hmm.
You can tell.
Oh,
obviously.
Absolutely.
But we have to move. We have to move to a subject I want to talk about here, and that is where Harrison Ford was at this point.
Harrison Ford was
the most popular actor out there at the moment.
Because this was. What? This was 5 years after Star Wars, 2 years after Raiders.
No, this was a year after Raiders.
Right, a year after Raiders, 2 years after Empire.
Between 1980 and 1985, he had one hit after another.
Mm-hmm.
Because in 1980 he had Empire, in 1981 he had Raiders. 1982 he had this, which I won't call this a hit, but ultimately it was.
Mm-hmm.
83 was Jedi, and 84 was Temple of Doom, and then 85 was Witness, and his only Oscar nomination.
Right.
The thing is...
Did Frantic in 88 do pretty well, too? That was a good movie.
Yeah.
Roman Polanski did that one.
He is underrated as an actor,
mm-hmm.
I believe. And the proof of that has come in the last 10 years. Because he has taken to retconning all of these hits.
Mm-hmm.
The three major roles of his career. You know, with Indiana Jones, with whatever you feel about Indiana Jones. then with Star Wars, and then with this. The thing is, in each case, he's committed to the character.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
He's not, because you can always tell when Harrison Ford doesn't want to be there.
Mm-hmm. But Return of the Jedi. Temple of Doom.
When he played, when he came back to play Indiana Jones, he played Indiana Jones.
He was the best part of that movie.
When he came back to play Han Solo, he played Han Solo.
Right.
It wasn't just like, I'm here getting paid, whatever. Right. You never felt like that. There is an actual performance in all three movies. And even in the Blade Runner, and even in the Blade Runner sequel.
Mm-hmm.
There's a performance there to which you can feel like you are watching the same character.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
You're not just looking at the actor, you know, getting paid. So I always feel like he's a dedicated actor. He's a good actor. He just does not get the credit that I think that he deserves.
Because he was thrust
into... He's a lot like Robert Mitchum. He doesn't emote like a lot of actors do.
Well, no, and his big entree into fame were action movies and sci-fi movies.
Action sci-fi.
So, just like Mark Hamill. Mark Hamill is a way better actor than he has ever been mm-hmm. given credit for. And because he made his name with Star Wars, nobody takes him seriously. Carrie Fisher should have worked much more as an actress.
Well, Mark Hamill, you know, time makes fools of us all.
Mm-hmm.
By not having the mega hit career follow-up,
mm-hmm.
was able to do what he wanted to do.
Yes.
He started developing a comic book. He started doing the voice of Wing Commander. He started doing these little smaller projects. And then Batman came along.
Yeah.
And he got a second, and his career just really got a second wind.
Mm-hmm.
And now he's not a megastar, but he's a beloved actor. He's mm-hmm. out there. He's kind of like, it's a little like John Goodman. He's not an actor that wins all the awards in the world, but everybody looks at him and they love him.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I'm telling you, if you've seen his performance in the second season of Nightfall, it's wonderful.
Is it?
He is so great. Hmm. He plays the initiate trainer to the Knights Templar.
I've seen a clip of it.
It's okay. Really good.
Hmm.
The only thing is you have to get through the first season to get to him. But Carrie Fisher, read her book and you'll figure out where this went.
I did. I've read three of her memoirs.
Yeah.
Actually, I've listened to them and she read them. So, yeah.
Her books are best when she's reading them.
Oh, yeah.
But she, of course, all the problems that she had.
Oh.
She made movies. Mm-hmm. But, you know, there was never anything that reached the heights of Star Wars.
No. She.
But she found her niche, and she found her niche with writing and, you know, with her one-woman show.
She was a hell of a writer.
She was. She was.
And what was it? Wishful Drinking.
Yeah.
I saw that on HBO. It is amazing.
You haven't lived until you haven't lived until you've been a Pez dispenser. But again, I will say this on Blade Runner. Having seen it recently with the final cut, the problems that I have still exist.
Mm-hmm.
But I appreciate it now more than I ever did. And in large part, my appreciation for it comes from the sequel.
Which is just an amazing picture.
It's not everybody's favorite.
No.
The box office proved that. I think they did with the box office the same. I think they had with the box office the same mistake they had with Solo. They projected it so high that it could never have reached.
Right.
And it is directed by a guy who I think is going to become a legend.
Denis Villeneuve.
Denis Villeneuve, who is his body of work already. He's a French-Canadian director, and his body of work is unbelievable.
He's remarkable. He's responsible for my favorite movie of 2016, Arrival, which is one of the smartest sci-fi movies ever. It's like up there with 2001 and... And it's like, I love Arrival. Mm. You haven't seen
it. He also made Sicario.
He did, which is probably my least favorite. But he also made Enemy and...
Sicario was... the only issue I had with Sicario is that I felt like it crapped out at the end. Because where the movie does a very good job of showing you the drug culture, the FBI has to cross the line to stop. The end of the movie goes inward into this revenge plot instead of outward to show you the larger scope of the problem.
Right, and then the sequel is just all Benicio del Toro shooting people.
Playing the toughest guy I've ever seen in my life. He gets shot through the face. Two guys come up next to his car and start shooting at him. He doesn't even look at them. He pulls out a hand grenade and he just tosses it out the window. Like, this is the toughest guy I've ever seen in my life.
If this wasn't technically supposed to be based on a true story, I think he would have been a great action hero for Benicio. But
because that's the kind of stuff I would expect Chuck Norris to do. Right. I mean,
Sicario, for me, it felt like a 2-hour-plus commercial on why we need ice, and I didn't connect with that.
Yeah.
And it's well-directed. I just don't really like the movie.
Came around at the wrong time. Mm-hmm. Because
it would have been worse if it came out now.
That kind of portrait of the drug culture south of the border is probably not what we need right now.
No, and it's obviously been embellished and exaggerated too, but Blade Runner 2049 is... Whew.
This movie, I didn't know what to expect. And I stayed away from spoilers.
Me too.
I didn't read reviews. Although, I did go down and read some of the Rotten Tomatoes. You know, I read some of the Rotten Tomatoes
the
quotes.
The blurbs, yeah.
Especially the negative ones. And I was like, what movie were you watching? There's no character development, and this movie never comes above just being a pale imitation. I'm like, what movie were you watching? Did I click on the wrong review?
This
movie is astounding.
So, I love that they kind of talk about how the whole situation in 2019 led to the eventual disruption and destruction of the Tyrell Corporation.
Yeah, they keep talking about a blackout.
They showed what happened. Mm-hmm. Nexus 8s, Roy Batty and Pris and all of them, they were Nexus 6.
Yeah.
So, two generations later, Dave Bautista is a replicant.
Mm-hmm.
And at one point, mm-hmm. there was like a Nexus 8 uprising.
Mm-hmm.
And they show this. You know what? It's not in the movie. There's three little short films.
Yeah, because I haven't seen short films.
They're on the Blu-ray. I did watch them, but I didn't pay attention as closely as I should have, which is, you need to pay attention with all Blade Runner things.
You really need to listen, because... If you're sitting there and you're watching this and you're on your phone, you are going to lose this story.
Well, because I saw this, I've seen this twice. I saw it in the theater, and I loved it, but I realized that I had no idea what was going on, because I think I didn't hear two lines of dialogue properly, so I didn't understand what the story was at all. Because these are, this and Blade Runner, if you miss a couple of sentences, it's not going to make sense.
This happened to me the other night when I was watching it, because I saw something happen. I was watching it in my living room, and something happened, and it distracted me for a second. And when I came back, I was like, I am completely off the story. So I had to back up, and I was like, oh, okay, I get it, okay.
Right. So this one, this time I was watching it, I want to say when I saw it in the theater, I was by myself. It was like a really late show. Big screen.
Literally
like,
by yourself?
Yeah. Like, I was the only person in the theater.
This and God's Not Dead.
God's Not Dead 3. The Search for More God.
The Search for More Money.
Well, yeah. So, when I rewatched it, I made it a point to really understand and pay attention. And, like, I had missed in the theater that Ryan Gosling was a new version of replicant, who are subservient, so they don't. There's no possibility of that, so they send them out to be Blade Runners because they're as tough as the people that they're hunting.
If you missed the line from Dave Bautista, he says, "How can you kill your own kind?" If you miss that line, you'll miss the next hour. The next hour of the movie will be just completely cold to you.
Well, they do try to they do remind you a lot that he's a replicant. Apparently you can somehow tell by looking at them, I guess. But when he goes back to his apartment, the skin job is on his door, and they do talk about it a little. I love his character. They do the same thing with the detective work, but he has a real heartfelt relationship with his hologram girlfriend wife.
Joy.
It's sweet.
I adore her.
Yeah.
I don't know this actress, but I just fell in love with her. She is marvelous.
Yeah.
She's a Cuban Spanish actress, and I've never seen her before, but I was just like, I want to see you as the star of a movie, because I was just captivated by her. I was as captivated by her as he was.
Yeah.
And, you know, you realize, you know, if you were to invent a girlfriend, this is what you would invent. So it makes perfect sense that she is the way that she is, because this is what he has created.
And she's integral to the plot.
Right.
Like, somewhere else, this would be, his scenes with her would be just breaks from the action, or
whatever. Right.
Not here. She works with him a little bit. She goes with him. She kind of makes her own observations about things. She's part of all of it.
Well, if this were a meat and potatoes action movie, her function in the movie would be to absolutely assure you that the character is not gay.
Yeah, pretty much.
Yeah. But this character is so well developed from a personality perspective that you understand why he is attached to her, why she's in his life because she is, she's a sanctuary.
Mm-hmm.
The world is cold. The world is ugly. It is unforgiving. And he comes home, and there she is, and she's smiling, and she's got these eyes. This whole movie,
mm-hmm.
163 minutes, leans on what it means to be a human being.
Yeah.
What constitutes being a human being? What qualifies you to mm-hmm. be a human being? It asks questions that are in the movie, but it also asks questions that are outside of the movie,
mm-hmm.
because we question how we see each other.
Mm-hmm.
How do we treat one another?
Right.
And I thought about this weekend. I went to a film festival, and it was downtown, so there were several homeless people on the street. And I thought to myself, you know, I thought back to this movie. I thought, okay, this person's laying on the street. I'm comfortable in my home, but we are effectively the same.
Mm-hmm.
We are both, you know, we are both flesh and blood.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we both breathe the same air, but our circumstances are different.
Right.
But my being in a home and him being on the street does not make me a better person.
No, not at all.
Not at all.
And
it's all, it doesn't limit his, it doesn't put a limit on his humanity.
Right.
Who he is. And that's the kind of texture that this movie has,
mm-hmm.
because it's asking these questions. That you, it, this is a challenging movie. You have to think about it.
And I love that the whole plot is based around one group of people trying to cover up the fact that a replicant became fertile and gave
birth. Trying to bury it, yeah.
And the other one wants all the information it can get and the child so that they can put the capability of procreation into replicants because they don't have the capability of manufacturing as many as they need.
Yeah.
But as Robin Wright says, you know, this would break the world if...
Mm-hmm.
If people have to start thinking of replicants as people,
mm-hmm.
the whole system falls apart, just like slavery.
Sounds like the civil rights movement.
Yeah, a little bit. And
it's like you don't want to think of African Americans as human beings because equal human beings because then you have to start thinking of them as equal human beings, and a lot of people don't want to do that. It's that superiority thing, again.
Right.
Am I better than this person?
Right. So it's just kind of it's fascinating about how they did that, and like we're saying, if you miss a couple of sentences, large swaths of this movie are just not going to make sense.
Not one thing is put into this movie to get you on board.
No.
There's no fan service at all.
No.
I can't think of a single moment in this movie that is just fan service. You know, I'm gonna show you these things and I'm gonna do these things because you know, it's never that never comes up. It's not a thing. Villeneuve is making his own movie,
mm-hmm.
and I know that Ridley Scott didn't like this movie.
Didn't he?
He didn't.
Huh.
He pointed out all the reasons why it didn't succeed. He said it was too long, too slow, too many scenes go on for too long. I appreciated all of that.
I appreciate
the time and the generosity that everyone that everyone put into this.
The funny thing is that Ridley Scott's complaints are exactly how he made his movie.
Right.
Because Villeneuve was very, very true to the style that Scott set up.
Yeah.
So the reason that it's kind of slow and complex and everything is because the original was slow and complex and very detailed. And I kind of think that the original probably could have benefited from 15 or 20 more minutes to round out
half hour
to round out the characters a bit more.
Well, the round out the characters a bit more, especially the replicants, because here the replicants, the chief complaint that I had in the first one is solved here. Mm-hmm. Because I feel for the replicants, absolutely, especially Kay, who, I mean, he's the lead character, obviously. Right. But the thing about the first one is, I'm thinking, okay, you cast as the replicants Rutger Hauer and Brian James. Okay. Already, I can't get in the room with you to feel for these characters. Okay? Because when these guys come in the room, I'm done for. Okay?
And the first one, the original was all based around the idea of replicants as bad.
Yeah.
Which is funny because off anywhere outside of Earth, people probably really like them because they're very useful, very helpful. But because they're illegal on Earth, they're set up as bad right off the bat, that they staged a revolution and they escaped. Gee, slaves want to escape. Who knew?
Can you imagine? A slave revolt. We've never heard of that before.
Sentient beings don't want to be enslaved. Who would have thought? Like, that's not even something that people would have originally... the first thought that they had... Oh, if I were enslaved, I'd want to get out.
I mean,
but why are these people trying to get out? That doesn't make any sense.
You don't want to be treated like a... You don't want to be treated on the same level as a pickaxe and a shovel and a mule?
Exactly. I mean, you know. It's like, yeah, don't be so surprised when... Like, there was a Lewis Black bit where he said that, you know, the government needs to spend money better because there was a $500,000 study done to figure out why prisoners want to escape from prison.
Because they're in prison.
Like, so, I don't not... Like I said, I feel bad for those replicants on a general principle, but not on an individual level.
Yeah.
2049, replicants themselves are not the bad guys.
Right.
Even Dave Bautista at the beginning, you should think of him like... Roy and Pris and Leo or Leon and I can never remember the fourth one because they get to her and then they kill her, and all I know is that she
she's the showgirl.
Yeah all I know is that the snake goes places that it shouldn't.
Right. I'll tell you, the only other place I've ever seen Joanna Cassidy was in Who Framed Roger Rabbit. She played Dolores.
Oh!
But, yeah. Gee, Eddie, is that a rabbit in your pocket? You're just happy to see me.
I would not have been able to put that together. I did not know
that. That was her.
They are very different appearing people.
But
Do you know what my first thought was?
Oh, Zora. Zora Salome.
Yeah, my first thought when I'm watching all of these all at once, when she goes and she gets into the shower, I thought I would not want to be the person that has to clean her dressing room because the drain, because of all those huge chunks of glitter that she had on her, that when she came out, she wasn't wearing them, so they got washed off. It's like, where did they go? They're all, like, stopped up in the drain. Like, my thought was, like, I would not want to be the guy that has to clean her shower.
They'd send in a replicant to do the plumbing.
Probably.
But you know what? Here's the
thing. Oh, no, they couldn't because it's on Earth.
Yeah, well, here's the thing that here's the thing I don't understand. This is supposed to be the future.
Yeah.
They have all the technology in the world. You don't think that somebody would have invented a freaking scanner to figure out which one was a replicant and which one wasn't? Well, don't you think that that would have been a nice fail-safe if they would have figured that out?
See,
did they make them too human?
See, that's the thing. Tyrell was interested in perfecting it to the point of basically just creating his own humans.
Right.
There was genetic manipulation, there was growth, these are not just, these aren't the androids in Alien.
He basically did what John Hammond did. He put so much effort into figuring out whether or not he could. He never figured out whether or not he should.
But at the same time, like, if they had not turned them into a servant-slave class,
yeah,
it wouldn't have been the problem.
Right.
But, I mean, here you have the same problem that the Matrix had. Mm-hmm. It's like, you force people into submission, they're gonna fight back. Mm-hmm. If you put them out there and say, hey, these jobs are available.
Yeah.
And they can work and they can live like regular people. Mm-hmm. They'll just live like regular people.
Right.
So, and this is going back to the original, but still.
And again, to your point, it's like, it's the second one has so many current themes. Mm-hmm. This struggle for equality that goes on right now among minorities, among the LGBT community, among anybody else, and you know, anybody that is basically cut off and not given an equal chance,
right,
to do the same thing that people have been allowed to do for 200 years.
Right, everybody who's not a white man.
Right. Right, and you are not, you are, because you are this way, you are not equal to the same rights that I have.
Right.
Because I saw it in a book I like. You know, and you get down to that point, it's like, well, why, someone said to me once, why do you gay people do all of this? And I'm thinking, because you told them no.
Yeah.
For no reason.
Right.
And it's
the same thing here. You make people hide who they are.
Right. And you made people subservient. And you made people subservient. You push their back to the wall, and they're like, no.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, we're the same as you. We're going to fight for what we believe in. Mm-hmm. And the replicants in the movie are the same way.
Yeah.
The only thing is, every single evolution that they have, every single development that they have, scares people to death. And this revolution, this strange, what gets the ball rolling, is the fact when they find these bones in a box. Mm-hmm. Which I'm going to admit something. When I saw the movie initially, I knew whose bones were in that box.
I figured it out pretty quick. Yeah.
Yeah, I figured that out pretty quick. Because when they find a serial number etched on one of the bones, that's Rachel.
Right, as soon as it was a replicant and they said that there was a birth, I was like, oh, Rachel. Yeah. She was a very special unit.
What I missed was I looked at it and I said, okay, it's him. I said, okay, he's about 30 years old. Yeah, it's him.
Yeah, I thought that it would be as well, and I thought that that would be an interesting twist. I'm really glad it wasn't him.
Yeah, I'm too.
The sleight of hand that they did in then him going to the memory expert, and she confirms it's a real memory, but she doesn't say that it's his real memory.
Yeah.
Because it's hers.
Yeah.
And,
yeah.
She is so sad.
Yeah.
And I love that there is all of this. A lot of people die to find her.
Including our main character.
Including Kay. But they're basically, what's his name? Jared Leto ultimately has to be let down because the only product, the only offspring of a human and a replicant cannot live outside.
Right.
So she couldn't do all that work that they want them to do because apparently after a certain point they have no immune system.
Right.
So, obviously, they would have to do genetic tinkering, and they would probably be able to fix that in utero if they're monitoring it. But, obviously, they couldn't have a doctor monitoring her because, well, she was not supposed to have existed.
Right.
Both Rachel and the daughter. What I love, there's so many things to love about 2049.
I think there's almost everything to love about 2049.
Yeah. I can't really come up with...
Let me put it this way. You may hear about this again later. Yeah. This movie may come up on this show later.
Yeah.
It might.
More than once.
But what I appreciate about this film, and I've seen this movie 6 times.
Oh, wow. I've only seen it twice.
And what I appreciate about this film is the absolute generosity of it, the generosity of the visuals. This movie never panders.
No.
It never, you never feel like, you know, because sometimes a sequel can feel like a fast buck operation.
Yeah, this is not.
They're just throwing this out there, you know. This is never that.
This is
never
not that
for one solitary moment is this any of that. I appreciated the questioning nature of humanity. Who am I? Where did I come from? Why am I here? All of these questions that he's asking, he's questioning himself. You know, who I am real?
They're human questions.
They're human questions, and probably more human than human. And
that's their goal at the Tyrell Corporation.
Yes, he is. You know, well, if I'm not human, what am I? You know, and if I'm not, and if I'm not human, and I'm not worthy of living, why am I living? What is my function? What is my purpose? Am I only living for my function? And it's a massive question that is asked in this bleak, unforgiving landscape. There's no place in this entire movie that looks like it was made for comfort. There are 137 different locations in this movie.
Yes.
And every single one of them is so spare and so Orwellian.
Oh, this is the best looking wasteland.
Yeah.
I mean, since maybe Fury Road.
This is the best looking movie I would not want to live in.
Exactly. Because, and this should be mentioned, this finally after, what, 8 or 10, 12 nominations, Roger Deakins finally won an Oscar for this?
I'm so glad you mentioned Roger Deakins, because his hands are all over this movie.
Oh, yeah.
What about the colors that he chooses? The bare white when Kay goes back to the office and he's having his baseline testing.
Right.
What about when he goes out to Vegas and it's this sickly yellow green?
Yeah.
And he's standing amid all of these massive, enormous statues of naked women.
Uh-huh.
And, you know, Vegas was this pleasure palace. Mm-hmm. And, you know, and what about when you go to Jared Leto's office, the Wallander office, and it's this office with this fountain and the light is bouncing off it and the whole room
pool.
Is,
yeah.
The whole room is moving.
Yeah, and the inherently neon-ness of every street scene in Los Angeles. Just there is just neon everywhere.
Yeah.
In every nook and cranny, it's lit with this neon hologram technology, and it's all about consumerism.
Right.
Which is, that's a thing Philip K. Dick had. I mean, if you watch, look at Minority Report, which could also easily exist within this world.
And so could Total Recall.
Yeah.
All of the worlds that he created, he was very Orwellian in his approach.
Very much so.
Because it was never, it's never a future you want to live in.
No.
And it's always technology clashing with humanity.
Mm-hmm.
I'll tell you, this Blade Runner 2049 is what I had hoped for. I didn't even realize that I had missed it. Had hoped for and missed from the reboot of Battlestar Galactica, because that show deals with the same themes that this movie deals with,
mm-hmm.
in almost the same way. But this rings the bell a little better than that show did.
See, I only ever got to see the miniseries. I didn't get to that launched the reboot of Battlestar Galactica. I didn't actually get to watch the whole show, and I didn't see any of Caprica. So
it was effectively Caprica. Boy, that was a marvelous show that just didn't get a chance.
Yeah.
But they the tagline for the show was "Never create what you cannot control." Which is a misnomer, because if you watch Blade Runner, you realize if you create something, you're not going to be able to control it.
You can't control it.
You can't control it. And effectively, machines take over. They become the dominant because they will not be enslaved.
Right. The Cylons don't want to. They're sentient beings.
Right.
And sentient beings cannot, no matter what, be coerced into thinking that they should be less than other people, or that they do not merit the same. And when you create, when you engineer a sentient species that is stronger, faster, and smarter than you, you're doomed.
They only kill their masters.
You're doomed. That is essentially saying, hey, I want to figure out how to kill everyone.
Mm-hmm.
All right, I will make something that can think better than me, can move faster than me, and is 10 times stronger than me, and could crush my skull with a glance. I'm going to make that and mass produce it. Nothing could go wrong.
Yeah.
No!
Because nothing can go wrong. Absolutely nothing can go wrong. Welcome to Itchy and Scratchy Island, where nothing can possibly go wrong.
Gee, so who knew this would happen? who knew?
Nothing could possibly go wrong.
There has never been any precedent for all of this stuff going wrong like this. It has never been seen in the history of humanity. Except everywhere.
But then you also get into this theme of supremacy.
Mm-hmm.
Because anytime that something, an element that is relegated to second class, begins to question its own existence and its own place in society, as it does in this movie, there is this element of supremacy that is, you know, they want the fruits of modernity, but then they want it to remain as they're in, within their comfort level.
Mm-hmm.
And then that confusion is in looking for somewhere to go, and it goes into intolerance.
Mm-hmm.
And it creates this atmosphere of supremacy. So then you have a group who are looking to control those that they have subjugated.
Mm-hmm.
And it's usually done through violence.
Yes.
And the excuses are usually, in our culture, the excuses are usually religious.
Yep.
And because they saw it in a book they like. And they come down to...
Sky cake!
They come down to, this is the way I want things to be. They're wrong because of this.
Right.
And that's when this organization is trying to kill K, is trying to take out all of the elements that would reveal what is going on.
Mm-hmm.
That's what that is. It's that supremacy.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that is then the thing is, you can kill K, you can wipe the Rachel and the child off the map, but it's going to happen again.
Mm-hmm.
It's going to evolve, and things are going to happen. There's a woman that comes up to Kay at the end of the movie, and she's effectively talking about going to war.
Mm-hmm.
She's talking about this this movement that's going on. And I'm thinking, you are talking about starting a war between the two, which is what the Robin Wright character was warning against.
Mm-hmm.
And the sickening thought is the fact that this situation that is going on, that is happening here, a war is basically inevitable. Because you're always going to have those that are subjugated, the replicants, and you're always going to have that supremacy, the human beings who don't want the equality.
Mm-hmm.
So therefore, it's... While this movie does have a beautiful ending...
Mm-hmm.
It's also very bittersweet, because the story is not over by a long shot.
And both Ridley Scott and Villeneuve have said that there is a third part to make.
I'm okay with that.
And absolutely. Especially, I mean, really, if Villeneuve comes back, I'm totally on board.
I'm on board with Villeneuve coming back with anything. I mean,
that's true.
As long as the quality of his work, this could have gone wrong in every single conceivable way. They could have made just a reboot and just thrown in, you know, Raja Gosnell as the director and just a lot of special effects and just, you know, this could have been...
And made money.
And made money. And, you know, a lot of idiots would have gone to the theater. Look at that, they're hitting people.
Mm-hmm.
And then, you know, I'll go back and see it again. You know,
there's naked girls and they're shootings.
But there's this visual stuff in this movie. I was fascinated by the scene where he's sitting there in Vegas and this ginormous woman walks up to him, this hologram, walks off of the billboard.
Yeah.
And she's naked.
Mm-hmm.
And she's seducing him, not with sex, but with, you know, you look like you've had a hard day. You know, that kind of thing. It's a very interesting...
After he got back to L.A., but yeah, that was a... That's a...
Oh, was it when L.A.? Okay, right.
It's right, but it's right near the end. It's just the whole... My fear would be that Ridley Scott would do what he did with Alien... and try to go back.
Yeah.
But not in the same spirit that the original was done.
Right.
Because I like Prometheus.
I still like Prometheus.
I have not yet seen Covenant. I will see it, but yeah. I haven't seen it yet. But I don't... 2049
you're okay.
Yeah. 2049 works as well as it does because it is a fresh perspective looking at using something older for inspiration, but continuing that story in unexpected ways.
Right.
Blade Runner 2049 is the Star Wars The Last Jedi of... I guess the Blade Runner series, because
and it does what Creed did for Rocky.
Yeah,
is that it takes an idea and it doesn't repeat it. It expands on it.
Mm-hmm. It gives you more of the universe instead of rehashing what you already know, which
right.
is what it's why Star Trek is still entertaining and innovative and new, and why Star Wars is still fresh, because there's so much going on outside of the one character that you know. And this brilliantly loops the first film in with itself, but it also does a really good job of not making you have to have seen Blade Runner to understand Blade Runner 2049.
You don't need to have seen Blade Runner for this.
No. Because they really explain don't. Enough of it. And there's that opening crawl that basically tells you everything you pretty much need to know.
Although I had to squint to see it. What is it with these what is it with these titles? My God, they make them so tiny. And I'm like, I'm getting older. I can't read that stuff anymore. And half of it is in red. And the only reason the only reason I really got it was because I'd just seen the first movie.
Right. And it's that I hate it when they do like a dark blue on black.
Ugh.
Like old computer terminals.
Yeah.
Or like the Hunter Green on black. It's like, why are you making... You can't read things that are in a dark color on black. You can't... It's not conducive to the way our eyes work.
Right.
And if you're working in a visual medium, you should know how the eye works.
It's kind of like when they used
Just
to...
Just saying.
Kind of like when they used to release, when they first started, when home video started, they started doing subtitles.
Yeah.
And they would do white subtitles in a black and white movie.
That was the worst.
Yeah.
I remember missing swaths of movies because I couldn't read them because they didn't put the black background behind the white subtitles, or they didn't put the subtitles in yellow, or
something. I couldn't watch 8 and a Half because of that. Because not that Fellini needs subtitles, but I was like, the first time I rented 8 and a Half, I was like, I'm really interested in seeing this. And I sat there and I watched it and I was like, wait a minute, the subtitles, I can't see them because they're bleeding into the background.
Right, right. The same thing happened to me with La Strada, another Fellini, and the first copy of Seven Samurai that I had. Bits and pieces, it got lost.
Let me ask you a question. This is kind of another topic, kind of on the subject. Do you do closed captions?
Yes.
I do too. Because I've noticed, and maybe it's my sound system, maybe it's my hearing, these new sound systems, there are moments when I miss dialogue.
Me too. I started doing closed captioning way back when I started getting into film because I wanted to train myself how to read subtitles. Because I knew I was going to have to, and when I first started watching them, I could only see the bottom, and I was reading along, but I would miss a lot of what was happening. So I had to train myself to be able to watch something while I was reading.
So you read using the subtitle just to get it.
So reading what I'm listening to in English helped train my eyes and my brain to be able to watch something in another language and read the English at the bottom.
I work in a store where we sell DVDs, and this kid, probably 15, walked up to me and he handed me an anime and he said, "Is this dubbed or does this have subtitles?" And I looked at it, and of course the writing on the back of it is that 2-point, you know, that 2-point contour type, and I'm squinting to see it. And I said, "Yeah, it's got dubbing." And he goes, "Yes."
Well, see, the funny thing is, when DVD came around, I think I've told this story. Subtitling and dubbing, you didn't have to make sure you got one or the other, because there would be an English language track. There would be, you know, when I worked at Blockbuster, Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon came out.
Mm-hmm.
There was this huge, full panel, like a whole wall, was just dedicated to Crouching Tiger. Big release. A day after it comes out, we have to restructure it so that we can put a sign in the middle that says,
"Warning,
this movie is subtitled."
Because people kept bringing it back.
And then I experienced something very interesting where somebody walked up to the counter, handed it to me, and said, "What does subtitled mean?"
Oh, God.
And I said, "Well, it's in Mandarin Chinese, and you read the English at the bottom." "Oh. Don't you have any dubbed?" This was on VHS. I said, "Don't you have any dubbed copies?" And I said, "Well, no, but if you get the DVD, it has the English language track if you want it." "Well, I don't have a DVD player." "I guess you're reading or you're not watching it." And then my assistant manager got a phone call. This woman was screaming at her.
Wow.
Because Crouching Tiger is subtitled.
Yeah.
They didn't know.
Mm-hmm.
And my husband can't watch this because he can't read. That's his problem and not ours.
I missed the part where that's my problem.
Like, we rent videos. We are not a remedial studies. This isn't a prison bookstore. We rent movies. Livid that we had the audacity to present a movie that was not in English for her husband to not be able to read.
Yeah, what's wrong with you?
I felt bad that he couldn't read, because this was an older couple. Like, this was like 50s, mid-50s, early 60s. I felt bad for him, but I didn't feel bad for the wife yelling at us like it's our fault that the Chinese made a movie, that a movie was made in Chinese and sent over here and did well. That's not our fault.
Yeah.
It's your fault for not reading and not understanding. Well, presumably she could read.
Yeah.
But you didn't look. It's on you.
Yeah.
You assumed that because it was a video in an American video store, it was in English. That's on you.
Well, so that kid who handed me that anime, he was so happy that it was dubbed. I'm like, I have no sympathy for you.
None.
Because I'll tell you what I did. The first time I saw Ghost in the Shell, it had subtitles. But it had a track that was in English. Now, they've done a lot better with the dubbing, you know, not like the old karate films.
Where
it doesn't feel like the person's in the next room.
No, they actually try to translate and make sure that it lines up as much as possible.
They'll do this thing also where they'll get American actors or they'll get other actors to dub, to do the voices naturally. So that it doesn't feel like, you know, they've just pulled somebody out of the, you know, the front office and just had here read lines.
Right.
They actually are trying.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't need it.
No, I don't either. Animation is one thing. I will, if I'm taken with a foreign language, non-English language, animated film, I will give the English language track a shot because the dubbing doesn't have to be as precise.
Right.
And it's not like you're watching someone not making the movements for the words that you're hearing. That was always my thing. I like subtitles because I want to hear the actual actor's voice.
Yeah.
And get into their performance. Like, if I'm watching an American dub over an Asian person, the movie stops being believable. Because we're not getting that person's performance.
And the other thing is, it's also why I like silent films. I like the visual splendor of a film. Blade Runner 2049 is just a film that is, I don't even need dialogue.
Right.
A lot of the way. It could have easily been a silent film. You know, talk about a bold step. You can make just a silent film, just let the images, you know, suggest what you're seeing, you know, just, and you understand what's going on.
I cannot even envision the intertitles that there would have to be for a Blade Runner movie.
What if you didn't have intertitles?
Oof.
And you could just have it. You could just have the information come from the performances. Talk about challenging.
Oof.
But this is a movie you don't even have to. This is a movie that is just such a visual festival. I mean, you're sitting there and you're looking.
It's a treat. It really is.
It's a treat. Absolutely. I absolutely adore this film. Because of the questions that it asks, because of the technique, because of the generosity, because it will spend, and movies don't do this anymore, it will spend time with characters.
Yeah, there's everyone has a purpose here. You might not know their motive, but everybody has a clearly defined purpose. Even Dave Bautista at the beginning, he is a fully realized character.
Sapper Morton, I love that name. And people tell me all the time, you know, the things I love about this movie, people tell me all the time, you know, the less educated, I guess, tell me all the time, is like, well, I like that movie, that movie's boring as shit. And then they'll tell me something like, well, I turned it off after 5 minutes. I think, you got bored in 5 minutes?
It doesn't even almost start to tell you the story in 5 minutes.
I can't imagine a movie that you caught on to in 5 minutes. What? That's a commercial break.
Yeah.
Now, I understand this is a long, slow, deliberate movie. And I understand a lot of people wouldn't like this, but after 5 minutes, what?
There's no way to know what's going on.
Yeah.
Like,
what were you looking for in the first 5 minutes?
Right.
All right. So we've done a bit. We've done our bit for King and Country with this one. So, what do we got next? Well, next week is your choice.
Yes.
We're going back to. We're going back to the Middle Ages. To talk about Akira Kurosawa's Kagamusha.
Yes, The Shadow Warrior, 1980, presented by / co-financed by George Lucas and Francis Ford Coppola.
People that I work with have been born, raised, gone to school, gone to college, gotten married, and had children in the time that I've seen, since I've seen this movie.
I don't have that wide of a gap, but I've only seen it once, and
so did I, and it was about 1989.
Right. My 15-year-old was 2. Wow. Like, it's been a minute.
Yeah.
And after that we go from Middle Ages Japan all the way up to 80s and 90s Los Angeles.
Oh, yeah.
And then we head to the jungles of Vietnam.
Yeah. For my next choice after Kagamusha, I have chosen what I think is the greatest documentary of this decade and probably this millennium. I have chosen Ezra Edelman's O.J. Made in America, which says more about American culture than in any film I can ever think of. Yeah. And in 10 hours, it almost has to.
This one's long.
It's long.
It's marvelous. I can't say anything really disparaging about it, but it is.
It's long, but
it is a time investment.
Yeah. I watch it in bits. I've only sat down to watch it straight through once, but I've seen it in bits.
Yeah.
But this is Academy Award winner for Best Documentary, 2016?
Yes.
Okay. And then we are going to round out September with your choice, which is the 40th anniversary.
40th anniversary of Apocalypse Now. There is still 1 week after that in September that we have to come up with a, we're going to pick
and
together.
Then,
and then
it's Shocktober month,
which I have not made any picks for this, but
wrong with you. The last 3 months of this year are, our theme months. We do Shocktober in October. We do, Turkey Month in November, which we talk about bad movies. And then December, we do our Christmas movies. Mm-hmm. And at the end of December, we're going to talk about our individual list with the 10 best films of this past decade. I do not know what Doug has picked, and Doug does not know what I have picked. That's going to be a fun show.
No, but I have some really clean guesses of what some of yours are going to be. I'm not making them out loud, but I think I have some pretty good guesses as to bits of your list, not the whole thing.
All right, take us off world.
That does it for us here on the Pod Bay Doors. You can find us on iTunes and on YouTube. You can find all of our back episodes at thepodbaydoorspodcast.wordpress.com. You can find us on Twitter at @pod_bay. That is also our Patreon handle, so you can throw us a tip into our virtual tip jar. We would greatly appreciate any likes, upvotes, shares, anything that you can give us that would give us some kind of a profile out here. We know people are listening sometimes. And we definitely appreciate everyone who does. That about wraps it up for us here, and the Pod Bay Doors are now closed.
The mission has been completed. Thank you.
Machines dehuman.